The Texas Parks and Wildlife television series is supported in part by Texas Parks and Wildlife Foundation, conserving the wild things and wild places of Texas thanks to members across the state. Additional funding is provided by Toyota. Your local Toyota dealers are proud to support outdoor recreation and conservation in Texas. Toyota, let's go places.
Coming up on Texas Parks and Wildlife.
I don't think a lot of people think about seeds as living creatures, but that's exactly what they are.
Really, the big change for the family was when Natural Bridge Caverns was discovered in 1960.
Their declines are indicating to us that something's going on in our grassland systems that isn't healthy.
Texas Parks and Wildlife, a television series for all outdoors.
I don't think a lot of people think about seeds as living creatures, but that's exactly what they are. They encapsulate a future generation. That seed enables that plant population to persist beyond just that individual. Collecting and banking seed is important in the context of plant conservation because it essentially retains the genetic diversity of that population that you have collected from. The banking of seed can allow for future research to be conducted on that particular species. Banking that seed allows for reintroduction of populations that are destroyed. But if we have a backup of that population in the form of the seed, then we can reintroduce that population back into the wild at some later point.
It's the reason my knees will never be the same, my old seed collector knees. I'm Annette Moore. I am conservation botanist and research associate for Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center. In most of Texas, the rate of development is just very rapid. And even some of the plants that would have been very common here 50 years ago are becoming more and more uncommon. Ideally, we would be able to preserve enough habitat to have robust populations of these species. Sometimes that is just simply not possible. It's possible that the only way we can save that species is to seed bank it and hopefully restore the habitat or find similar habitat where the species can be grown out. Those seeds look good. One of the species that was a target for me was Malvastrum aurantiacum, or commonly known as Wright's false mallow. That had been mentioned as a common species in the area about 80 years earlier. And when we started looking for that, we simply could not find it. So this species occurs in just a portion of Texas, three of the ecoregions: Texas Blackland Prairie, the Edwards Plateau, the Western Gulf Coastal Plain. In some years, those three regions experience really dry times. Most of the wildflowers will just go dormant. But the Wright's false mallow, it is one of the few species that is producing pollen in the driest time of the year. And so for those solitary bees that are collecting pollen, that can make the difference for them. So it was really important to me if we could get that species and make it available for restoration purposes.
Looks good.
If every group that is interested in native plants, whether it's a garden club or a butterfly club, if each one of them would take one species and make a seed collection this year to share with the members in their group and their local schools, we could make sure that many species that are endemic don't end up being species of greatest conservation need.
The more we know about rare and common species in the state of Texas or in our own counties, the better prepared we can be to conserve and protect these species.
East Ranch has been in the family for five generations now. The first family members actually came and settled here in 1883. The family has been farming and ranching the property ever since and raised cattle and goats and sheep. Really the big, I guess, change for the family was when Natural Bridge Caverns was discovered, the major portion of it in 1960. Family always knew the caverns was there. Just a really unique natural feature across the landscape and on the property. Turned out to be the largest cave in the state of Texas. Four college kids from San Antonio got permission from my grandmother to explore below the natural bridge, and what they found really changed the course of history for this family. Really, my grandmother is one who we credit for kind of being the driving entrepreneur behind opening that to the public and choosing to showcase it. From that point, the family became intertwined in the nature tourism and agritourism industry. We still make our sole existence from the land and the property today, but it's shifted from livestock production to agritourism, nature tourism now with the operation of the caverns.
Look how high it is.
The Wiest Ranch is about 2,600 acres in both Bear and Comal counties, spans the Cibolo Creek, and is comprised of a variety of habitats. Yeah, this stand of soapberry is looking good. That's the other thing is to watch out for. It can look a lot like chinaberry, so you want to make sure you're not killing off soapberry.
We came in here a couple years ago treated chinaberry through this area. The bigger ones, we girdle cut them and around to kind of open the bark up and sprayed them. And I don't know, we probably did 15, 20 acres in this along this creek right here.
Yeah. That's good, yeah. Getting really good kill out of this. Excellent. When were these treated?
This was be 2 years.
2 years, okay.
Yep.
Oh, that's good. As any property in the Edwards Plateau knows, you deal with drought, you deal with unpredictable weather, you deal with generally thin, poor soils, not to mention there's a tremendous amount of development pressure all around them. The challenge of keeping the land together can't be ignored. They've done an excellent job of using a variety of conservation tools like easements to help ensure that this property is protected for a long time.
God's not making any more land. We have to take care of, you know, these amazing natural resources that we have the privilege of being, you know, stewards of.
We learned how to make things better for not just the cattle, but for the wildlife as well, so that the two, that there's a balance.
From a young age, I think Travis too, really developed an appreciation and a strong tie to the land.
We realized it was very special, and that it was our job to perpetuate that legacy and protect it and carry it on. It's really just been in the last few generations that we've really come to better understand just exactly the impact we have on the property and what we can do to help along the way.
Everyone's very familiar with the Riverwalk in town, and that's very nice, has restaurants and hotels, and very good for tourism. But this is also another section of the river. It's the very same river, but a much, much different setting, a much more natural setting.
We couldn't have asked for a better day to be on the river. Sun's not shining, a little overcast, not as hot. Wonderful.
The Mission Reach Trail includes 8 miles of paddling trails, as well as 15 miles of hiking and biking trails.
Pretty interesting river that gives you a lot of the city, but yet it gives you an opportunity to experience kind of a natural world. Because the grass and the vegetation is growing up around the river, it gives you the impression that you're not actually in the city, but you're right in the middle of the city.
We're gonna keep moving on down, guys. We're gonna keep moving.
Let's try to make it.
This is the first time I've been in a kayak.
Oh, we're gonna make it. We're gonna make it.
Yes, this is the first time I've kayaked.
Whoa.
Yeah, I'm always down to do new things. It's really fun.
That was cool.
Come on.
Yeah. I have not paddled this. This is my first time on this river.
Woo!
Yeah. It's really fun, actually. The little chutes that were going down. You get stuck every now and then. Make sure not to try to hit the side.
Oh!
There we go. We're moving again. And then when you get down, it's like, whew, we made it.
It's pretty fun, like riding down the water and going down the chutes. The chutes were like the best part, I thought.
We did it!
Yeah, it was just a really great experience just going down the river.
I couldn't even tell that I was in the city because I see houses on the side and things like that, but it was completely silent. You could hear the birds chirping, the ducks quacking and everything like that.
Yeah, buddy.
Because I live in the city and I just always see how chaotic it is and everything is just so loud and noisy. And it's just good to connect with nature and just be peaceful and just relax and take everything in.
Well, that was good, boy. All right, that was the best one yet.
It's vitally important. If we are ever gonna capture and rekindle our youth with the natural world, we've got to be able to make it accessible.
Oh my God.
It's a pure environment, and that's what we're trying to get the kids to hopefully reconnect with.
This is floating. Just takes you to a different place.
We're ready.
Okay, let's go.
Go.
We're at the Mims Ranch in Marfa, Texas.
Let's spread out a little bit more over here.
We're studying the wintering survival of grassland birds in the Chihuahuan Desert. We've seen a decline in grassland birds across the continent as a whole.
Bird! Bird!
The grassland birds that winter in the Chihuahuan Desert have seen a 70% decline, so they're declining at a faster rate than the other grassland obligate birds.
This is a grasshopper sparrow. Very yellow shoulders and a yellow like eyebrow right in front of the eye.
This project is trying to help us understand where in the bird's life cycle their numbers are falling off.
They're really cryptic. They're very difficult to see. So actually, for a long time, nobody realized that they were declining. I don't know. I think it's just kind of sad that they would disappear just because we never knew that they were out there.
The Mims Ranch is 11,000 acres of prime rangeland and healthy grasslands. This Chihuahuan Desert landscape provides a home for several declining bird species, like the grasshopper sparrow and the Baird sparrow.
They summer up in Canada and in the Dakotas, Montana, and the grasslands up there. And then they're migrating from there down to the Chihuahuan Desert, which crosses into Texas and all the way down into central Mexico. And there's pockets of grassland all scattered around the wintering grounds where these birds are found.
Okay, so everyone's ready? Okay, let's go.
It's late December, as this team of biologists, students, and volunteers set out across the Mims Ranch. They know there are sparrows in these grasses. They just have to find them and catch them.
Pat, Matt, go closer to the net, please.
The idea is to drive the birds to the net. They prefer to walk instead of flying, like their way to hide from predators and us. We kind of tap the grass to try to flush them out.
Bird, 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 bird.
And if a bird starts flying, we wave our arms and the sticks in the air.
Bird, 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 too.
So we're trying to keep the birds from going above the net. So this is supposed to make them think it's a predator.
That's not bird.
We throw it above them. They go down and they fall in the net.
Down, perfect.
Okay, good. So this is the Baird sparrow. It's a little bit different than the grasshopper sparrow.
In a week's time, the team will capture about 40 birds. Okay,
so this is a grasshopper sparrow.
They'll weigh them.
Two.
Measure them.
41.
Band them.
It's 14.
And outfit them with tiny radio transmitters.
All right, he's done.
Then they let them go.
One, two, three.
Over the next 3 months, researchers will track the birds every day.
We do track every bird every day. Some birds get lost. Sometimes we walk out to 15, 20 kilometers a day. And the grasslands are like really nice to walk on. You know, they're flat. You get like a nice breeze. To me, like this is beautiful. It's like going on a hike, just looking for our birds. You know.
So the different colors are different birds?
Once they have all the tagging and tracking information together, the team can map out where each bird has been.
The bird was caught there, and then it moved around a little bit, and then it finally went there, and it stayed there for the rest of the winter.
All this work will lead to a better understanding of what kind of habitat the birds like and don't like.
All of these grassland birds are really an indicator of ecosystem health. Their declines are indicating to us that something's going on in our grassland systems that isn't healthy.
Shrub encroachment is a big problem. The main predator for these birds is the loggerhead shrike. They perch on shrub to look for their prey. We know that survival is lower when shrub cover is higher.
Improper livestock grazing, suppression of natural fire, increasing non-native plant cover, and habitat fragmentation have all contributed to the loss of native grasslands. But here at the Mims Ranch, the owners know that protecting the watershed, improving the grasses, and raising cattle all go hand in hand.
So what's easy to happen in these drier environments is that you lose your ground cover. And so what we've been able to achieve out here with our grazing system is getting the ground covered with these good lower grasses, and it allows the water to absorb better, get better wildlife habitat, and even goes on and creates better forage for the cattle.
These grasslands here are grazed and they look great, and there can be cattle and birds at the same time. You can have both, cattle and grassland birds.
What these researchers learn will help landowners manage these vital grasslands in a way that is both sustainable and profitable. And that's good for wildlife and the bottom line.
The main problem for these birds is that their habitat is disappearing. There's not enough grass cover for them. Mims is a really good high quality grassland, so we get a lot of these birds here. They're telling us that this is good management, what they're doing here, that this is good.
Here we go, right now. The red over there lid. That was a transmittered a Baird sparrow that we just released. My first one, never seen a Baird sparrow until I came here. So that's kind of fun.
Celebrating a century of Texas state parks.
Huntsville State Park is located in the piney woods of East Texas.
And you turn down the road and you start driving through that tunnel. It's like this really cool portal that takes you away from the hustle and bustle. It all just kind of gets left behind you as you get deeper and deeper into the woods until you get to the park itself.
I like to say you can do anything with an ING here. That includes fishing, camping, biking, hiking, swimming, all kinds of fun opportunities outside. We have 187 campsites at the park, which may seem like a lot, but with the amount of trees that we have in the campground, you don't feel like you're on top of your neighbor and you still feel pretty secluded.
We are a CCC park. What they did here, they actually built the park itself. We have Lake Raven, which is a man-made lake where they built an earthen dam that blocked off the flow of three creeks and streams that go through this region of the forest. And by building that dam, they created the lake that we have today. And we wouldn't have it if it wasn't for the CCC.
You can swim in the lake in our designated swimming area.
The water is like, it's just like the perfect temperature. Oh, it's really fun. Like, there's a lot of activities to do. And also getting on boats is pretty cool.
Perfect.
So we have a boathouse here at the state park.
Awesome.
And you're a first-time boater and you'd like to try it out.
All right, see y'all later.
You can rent one here. That includes canoes, paddle boats, and kayaks.
Yeah, it's really pretty. I like how everything's curved in with the trees and how the wind is like blowing in my face and it's so fresh.
We're doing the Chinkapin Trail. It's a 6.8 mile loop that covers a pretty good section of the park. That's cool. What I really like about the trail is that it's really shaded, so it's good in all weather. It's really remote. It gives you kind of a feel of seclusion and a really good foresty vibe.
This park's rarely crowded, and so a lot of times you can hit the trail, and especially during the week, I got it to myself. Yeah, it's nice. It can get challenging, yes. You get a lot of gullies and draws that go in and out. I just love the exercise, and to be this close to nature and just to be out where you can enjoy it, it's a nice trail ride.
My name is Ranger Ted.
The alligator workshop is this really fun hands-on activity where I'll have a baby alligator.
Yep, go ahead.
For people to actually touch and feel and see up close.
Cool.
This one is a boy, this one's her brother.
How often do you get a chance to say that you got to actually touch a baby alligator? You got to feel it, you got to stroke its belly. So it's a really great opportunity for these families, these kids, these adults.
Go ahead and feel the belly.
To be able to go home and tell everyone, I touched and pet a baby alligator. So it's a really cool opportunity. Huntsville State Park is a really awesome place because it's home to all these different memories. And it's a great place to make new memories because of all the different things it offers.
If you're looking for your classic East Texas piney woods lakeside getaway, Huntsville State Park is definitely where you should stop.
Thank you.
This series is supported in part by Texas Parks and Wildlife Foundation, conserving the wild things and wild places of Texas thanks to members across the state. Additional funding is provided by Toyota. Your local Toyota dealers are proud to support outdoor recreation and conservation in Texas. Toyota, let's go places.